You know, Joe D, it's about time for another break. So that means we got to queue up another thing from Joe here. I know you were talking about some, you really got eloquent with some of your...
some of my British stuff.
Some of your descriptions, yeah. So
that's what happens when you watch Doctor Who too much.
Yeah, let's do that. Let's hear some of that, and we'll come back with more Motor Mouth Radio in a few minutes. Keep it where you got it.
All right, all you groovy, tuned-in, turned-on way out fans, here's a sample of your kind of music as we feature Eric Clapton, Ginger Baker and Jack Bruce, otherwise the Cream, in Strange Brew.
Hey, you in the car? Yeah, you. You're a fan of the music of Sly Stone. I know you are. No reason to hide it. You've probably been looking for a radio program that highlights his music. Well, then look no further. Let me introduce myself. I am DJ Solero. That's soul followed by air and an O. Solero. Well, never mind about that. Back to what we're both here to talk about. The Sly Stone Show features the music of Sly through the various artists who have covered and sampled his music, and I'll be playing some of the original music that helped impact a generation. Come on, I know you're looking for some feel-good music, so just keep your radio right here for the Sly Stone Show. And you might want to think about cleaning up your car before we start. This thing is nasty. Oh, back to what's important. It's the Sly Stone Show every Friday afternoon at 3 on the voice of Nassau Community College, 90.3 WHPC.
It's Ron Stevens. Did you miss me? Well, I'm making my triumphant return to WHPC. The Super 70s, Saturday mornings at 7, and the Central 80s, Saturday afternoons at 2.
Ron Stevens is back.
Memorial Day weekend.
Oh, it's so nice to be with you. I love all the things you say and do.
I'm the voice of Nassau Community College, 90.3 WHPC.
This is Dennis Pitzenberger from Sticker Shock, and if you're not listening to Motor Mouth Radio, boy, you are lost in the smoke of the burnout. Make sure and tune in each and every week because these guys are exactly what you want to hear. Real car guys, real talk, every single weekend.
Yeah, Strange Brew. We got a lot of strange. We got a lot of Strange Brew going around in here all the time, Joe.
Oh, yes. This place, what are you kidding me?
And this is great because this is all from a BBC session. So I know that was when you had that, you were overseas for a while. No one knew where you were.
Right.
You were in the overseas UD. And
the boat ride there was tough, yeah.
That must have been tough, yeah.
Yeah, you know what it's like trying to water ski behind an ocean liner?
I saw that on Mythbusters. They actually did it behind, I think they had like 40 water skiers. It was some kind of world record thing. I don't know.
That was just me being discreet in the outside there. Besides that, I had to get to England, to try to talk to Jack, Ginger, and Eric there.
When you gotta go, you gotta go.
Yeah, well, I don't travel the pond for everyone, you know.
I know that. Yeah. Well, it's got to be worthwhile, that's for sure.
Yeah. So talking about Strange Brew, should I tell the light bulb story?
Yes, please do.
Okay. So all right, let's see if I can try to cut this down. But this is like one of those times where knowing too much can actually be a disadvantage.
Okay.
And what happened is my rolling toolbox, my Chrysler Town & Country minivan, which, you know, doubles as my diagnostic hauling wagon there.
Mm-hmm.
I pull up in front of the house, get out of the car, and my foot hit the brake, just, I don't know why, and I saw, I had my headlights off, and I see my parking lights light up. I take my foot off the brake, the parking lights go out. I'm like, what's going on? Now, in my head, immediately goes through, all right, this stuff, having memorized the wiring diagrams, I says, all that stuff goes through the intelligent power module, which is over by the left headlight there.
The behind IPM?
Yes, and they're known for having all kinds of goofy stuff going on with them.
Right.
And I'm like, oh, okay. And, what goes through my mind is, okay, this thing, having done like a boatload of them at the shop for all kinds of different things, air conditioning, ABS brakes, power window, everything in the car electrical. It's the fuse box and the relay box for those minivans. It's like the 2001, 2007 Chrysler minivans. And I'm like, oh, God, now it's my turn. $400
yeah.
you know, for a new one. And from the you know, from the junkyard, which now you got to cross your fingers of what other problem you're going to pick up besides fixing yours.
Is that one under the hood or in the car?
It's under the hood.
Okay.
It's under the hood, and all the harnesses go to it. It's in a great spot because it gets battery acid on it. Thanks, Chrysler.
They probably mount it like right under the battery, right?
Right next to it.
Good place.
Yeah, I know. It's amazing. So, I went over to the UD the next night after I finished my my term of doing some diagnostics there at the shop. And I pull up the wiring diagram, and I start doing tests. I pull the parking route light relay out, check the fuses, you know, see if there, you know, I see there's power coming through places that there shouldn't be when I step on the brake. And I'm like, okay.
So now you're looking at something shorted.
Right. I see something shorted. And I'm like, okay, it's probably why he's touching on that. Or the problem with that fuse box, and actually this happens to quite a bit of more modern vehicles. GM had a big issue with some of this with their headlight circuits. And I fixed a couple of trailblazers that they actually died out. What happens is that inside that box, they're just thin metal strips
okay.
that run, you know, parallel to each other.
Mm-hmm.
And if they get hot, they start touching. Or they lose contact. You know, it all depends on which way he's going to screw you up the most.
Yeah.
And this thing had a definite backfeed through the parking light circuit from the brake circuit. Because when I pulled the brake light fuse out, everything stopped. And right. I says, okay, it's coming from there. And at that point, I said to myself, self, it's getting late. You're all right. You already missed Jeopardy. You didn't see what Vanna was wearing. You know, I mean, you got to go home because it's time to get up in the morning and, you know, start this all over again at like 4:30, 5 o'clock. So I buttoned everything up, went home with my lights still flashing as I stepped on the brakes. And, you know, they get some really odd looks from people, especially in the daylight. I was really happy when I had the headlights turned on because it wouldn't do that.
Yeah.
So a couple days go by. And, you know, I'm doing my research on how much the thing's going to cost. And I go back to the UD. I pull out my meter, pull out my test lights, you know what I mean? Have my wiring diagram taped to the side of the windshield so I could see it and everything. And I, you know, what just goes through my head in the diagnostic process sometimes, I remembered something that happened to me in, like, the 1980s when I was more of a pup with this. And I was over my partner Franz's house. We were doing something else, and I was talking about this thing I had to go friggin' troubleshoot there. And Franz's dad is a mechanic from way back, mm-hmm. and I told him what was going on. He goes, "Check the bulb, you dumbass kid. Two of the filaments shorted." I'm like, "What?" He goes, "Check the bulbs." So that went through my head. I heard his voice. And, yeah, right after the echo from the dumbass kid faded,
uh-huh.
Dougie and I proceeded to pull the taillights out of the toolbox one at a time.
Mm-hmm.
So disconnect the right side. Nothing. Step on the brake. Still happen. Disconnect the left side because on that, you can just pull the entire assembly, one plug, right out. It stops doing it.
Okay. Isolation.
Yeah. You know. Process of elimination, divide and conquer. Yeah, there's a couple of different ways of that announcing that strategy. And then the next thing I know, we pull it apart, we pull the taillight apart, and one of the bulbs is black.
Mm-hmm.
It looked like it got like, I don't know, 10 million volts through it. Or actually, I was thinking about it. I spend a lot of time in traffic because I was using that car every day to commute. And, you know, going up Northern Boulevard, you spend half your time with your foot on the brakes.
Sure.
And when I looked at it closely through the darkness, you could see where the filaments were touching.
Mm-hmm.
So I just took that one bulb out, put the taillight back in, because there's a lot of modern cars now have a circuit board which runs through everything mm-hmm. to distribute it rather than having a whole rat's nest of wires back there, and it stopped. So we pulled apart. The bulb now was the bulb was kind of melted to the socket. Now, it's Saturday afternoon. I think it was raining. It was dark. I was hungry. So we decided to pop the bulb out. So Dougie and I took our positions with two little picks, and we actually launched the bulb out.
Ooh.
Fixed the contacts. Got a bulb, stuck it in. Voila! It's done.
It's a bayonet style bulb.
Yeah, yeah. It's a 3157. I think
right,
it was.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay.
And We're back to normal now.
Wow.
Go figure.
Yeah, yeah.
But the moral of that story is like, I'm looking at wiring diagrams and, while I was at the UD, they're watching me talk to myself, drawing stuff with my little colored pencils and all that. And like, he didn't find it yet, Joe? I'm like, no, I got to pull the fuse box up next and isolate, parts, different sections of the fuse box. And then, like I said, I just got sick of it, put it back together, took a step back, thought about it, came back there a day, what was it, a day later, 2 days later. And it just kind of hit me while I was sitting there getting ready to dig in.
Right.
The simplest stuff, boys and girls, ladies and gentlemen, mechanics and tinkerers. Basically, you got the simplest solution is usually the best one you want to go with.
That's the thing. I know you, with your diagnostic training, you tend, I think just from history, just to go to the... to the worst case scenario, because you've seen so many worst case scenarios.
I go down the rabbit hole a lot.
Which isn't, that's how you train, so I understand that.
Right. Well, usually by the time it gets to me, somebody's already done the usual straight up dumb stuff. This, of course, was my own vehicle.
Well, of course.
So,
that's the thing. If someone called you and said, Joe, my car is doing this, what should I do? You would have told them exactly what you proceeded to do to check that.
Right. Device. Start breaking down the circuit, tracing it out and so forth. But in this particular case, that thing, when I encountered this, when I was, my first lesson in this was like 1985 or so.
Ooh.
All right. So I saw one other occasion since then to my own vehicle. So that's like, 30 years?
Right.
So it don't happen a lot.
It wasn't in the front of the diagnostic wheelhouse.
There you go. But sometimes you want to go with this. You want to eliminate the simplest stuff first.
Well, that's the thing. But, you are trained to do it a different way. So, it's...
Well, yeah, especially... And here's the other thing, the other takeaway from that, too, is that we all have... if you do a lot of this stuff, you get what you call the silver bullet or the red car.
Right.
Oh, that car don't start and it's red. It needs a fuel pump.
Exactly.
That car. Oh, okay. You want to fix that misfire on that Nissan? Yeah, you got to put coils in it.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And meanwhile, the car that you're actually working on may have, instead of a misfire that's coil related, it's actually an injector.
Right.
You know what I mean? Or the whole red car syndrome is like, you don't check, you immediately go for the silver bullet there, which you got to try to stay back from. Spend a few minutes doing the checks, or at least make sure you know how the thing works.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Well, and yours, it wasn't a singe you or a turnstile. It was like a nice gimme. You got a nice little break.
Yeah, I mean, we were laughing about it. I mean, that was a good one,
Especially
as my own car.
Unlike when I tried to work on my own car yesterday.
Oh, I'm out on this. Yeah, that phone call.
Oh, all I wanted to do, brought the car into the shop, do an oil change. I've had the serpentine belt and the AC belt for a year. I figured, let me change those. And, the serp belt was a piece of cake, but the AC belt is a stretch-type belt, which is very common these days. You cut it off the car because the AC compressor doesn't adjust. The belt actually stretches, and there is a tool to install it, much like a shoehorn, which I bought from Gates, same company that sold me the belt.
Right.
Which the tool, then I found out the tool didn't fit anything. They showed it going on the lower pulley, and in this case, that would be the AC compressor, which there's no way it was going to go in there.
Yeah.
So I threw the red flag out to you to say, Joe, what the heck is going on? You found some info that showed contrary. They showed you had some Mazda tools that worked off the top pulley.
Right.
Bottom line was, I could not put that belt on. And it really ticked me off because I bought the right tool.
Yeah, right.
Supposedly.
Ray is always very prepared. He's very organized. He doesn't go into stuff willy-nilly. You know what I mean? It's not like, how many hammers am I going to use to fix this? Ray goes in with a battle plan. And when somebody takes the battle plan and screws up the information that he, the assumptions that he has to work with, that's rough.
I can turn it to Johnny. That's what I'm going to do. Well, so... I'm going back. I'm going back today after the show, and I'm going to attack this because I watched some videos where they showed. I watched videos that showed how to install it with the tool, which would be easy. And there's other videos that show how to zip tie the belt to the pulley and kind of let it walk around. And they made it look really easy.
Right. There was the one guy there with like the vice grips and the C clamps and the
So I'm thinking that may be a plan. I got to give it a try because I'm just so ticked off that it didn't work with the tool.
Right.
That I want to go give it a shot. So you're more than welcome to come and watch the festivities if you feel.
Oh, this might be fun. Yeah. I mean, just so you know. A lot of these, the companies that put stuff out, and believe me, I know this from personal experience, you know, instruction sheets and test fitting and the various things that could possibly go wrong on your side because, you know, on the consumer side is that.